last lecture today. You guys need to go on break. Right? Okay. Liver. The liver is a really critical organ, as probably many of you know. But, you know, without it, we can't survive. It's another filter organ. It provides numerous functions. Filtering the blood, detoxifying drugs and chemicals, recycling blood, produces glucose, stores glucose. It's a really critical organ that we really take for granted, I think, most of the time. And which on the list here is not a function of the liver? Protein manufacture, lipid storage, detoxification, glycogen storage. Oh, yeah, I forgot. It manufactures bile. Which one of these is not a function? You know the answer is not. Because I just slipped on that one. They're all functions. Yeah, that's a trick question. I completely agree with you. But I want you to really appreciate all the different functionalities of the liver. So let's talk about some terms associated with the liver. Number one, bilirubin. Anybody tell us what bilirubin is? The breakdown of heat. Okay, when we recycle our blood cells, our red blood cells, the liver is involved in that process, and the heme group of the hemoglobin molecule, that heme group contains iron. A byproduct of that breakdown is bilirubin. Jaundice. Jaundice is a term that is referring to an overabundance of bilirubin in the system because the liver is not processing it fast enough. Usually these individuals will get yellow-colored sclera, or the whites of their eyes start to go a little yellow. They might have a little bit of a yellow appearance to their skin, especially if they're a fair-complected individual. The skin will look a little bit more yellow pigment, kind of a sickly-looking appearance. There's a lot of babies that are premature, that are born, that have jaundice. And the reason for that is they, if they're premature and the liver's not quite online yet, because the mother performed that function of filtering the blood, it may take a little time for their liver to come up to speed and then be able to recycle the bilirubin. Okay? And it's pretty benign for those kids because you can use laser or you use light therapy. So you put these kids under this, almost looks like a suntan lamp, and it breaks down the bilirubin for that period of time until their liver comes on. The other population that the lamp doesn't work for, just because of the fact that the liver is not coming online, it's basically offline, are chronic alcoholics that have cirrhotic livers. And so both those two patient populations are the ones that you'll see with jaundice. And we'll talk about alcoholic cirrhosis here in a little bit. Cholestasis. Cholestasis is a visible biliary pigment in the canaliculi and the hepatocytes because bile flow is blocked. Okay? Bile flow is blocked. This happens, unfortunately, in a lot of patients that wrestle with cancer of the liver. Ascites. It's not on the list, but I want to talk about it. Ascites is fluid accumulation in the peritoneum. So that's down here in like the abdomen. Fluid accumulation. We'll talk about how that occurs in a minute. Coagulopathy. The liver synthesizes and makes all of the coagulation factors except for one, factor 8. So it makes 12 out of the 13 factors. The one it doesn't make is factor 8. It's a lot of numbers, remember, right? 12 out of 13 doesn't make 8. So when the liver is compromised, blood clotting is compromised. If blood clotting is compromised, Could the patient suffer from an inability to harbor an appropriate inflammatory response? Let me repeat that. You're like, whoa, I didn't see that question coming. This is a review kind of question. If a patient has a compromised liver, and the liver makes coagulation factors, all 12 of 13, 12 out of 13, but not 8, would that patient potentially have compromised inflammation or the ability to heal or stimulate an inflammatory event? Yes. Why? Why? Clotting factors help with the margination of the white blood cells to get them out of the bloodstream. So you'd have a challenge of recruitment, right? And then the subsequent rolling, and then the tethering, and then the margination. That's exactly right. That's a pretty tricky review question, but I like that one. Okay, hypoalbuminemia. This is low levels of albumin in the blood serum. Albumin is the largest serum protein found in the blood, and it's made by the liver. And the role that albumin plays is to increase colloid osmotic pressure. That's the pressure or the encouragement of fluid to come out of the tissue and back into the venous side of the circulation. So by having large proteins that are stuck in the venous circulation, you basically recruit water to come in where those solutes are. And that's the role, that's almost the exclusive role of albumin. That's almost the only reason it exists, is to make sure that the venous side of the circulation has something attracting fluid out of the tissue and back into the bloodstream. That's what albumin does. So if the liver doesn't make albumin, what happens to the fluid? It stays in the tissue. Where do you think it accumulates? Usually, like right here. And you'll see that here in a second. I kind of gave the slide away, but we were on top. Which organs connect to the liver via veins? Small intestine, stomach, esophagus, spleen. Yeah, all of these. I'm in all of these mood. I'm just getting ready for Thursday. I'll take a little bit of everything. Alright. Like, I thought you said, yeah, I know what I said. I'm on vacation. So, what's ascites? Well, ascites is a condition where there's this accumulation of the perineal space, the perineal cavity. It can be caused by portal hypertension. Liver dysfunction itself leads to hypoalbuminemia, where you get a low production of albumin. And now this fluid sticks out in the periphery. Varices are what we call distended veins, right? The veins get distended. They get exaggerated because they're trying to find fluid, they're trying to bring it back in. So they dilate out as much as they can, and they become very visible from the surface. The picture that I want to show you is this one. This is what ascites looks like. Okay, so ascites is the accumulation in the perineal cavity. You can actually also appreciate these varices, because you can see these distended veins on this patient. This is a patient that's suffering from end-stage alcoholism. So the liver is being compromised. Now, unfortunately, something that is similar to this patient are these kids. And I can remember this clear as day when I was a kid. You know, I remember seeing these ads on the television of these starving kids. Back then, there was this huge drought in Ethiopia. It's always about Ethiopia. And there are parts of Ethiopia very dry, and there's parts that are actually very, very wet. But most of the country was in this monster drought, so there's just a lot of starvation in Ethiopia. And I remember as a kid thinking, like, you know, and you know, kids, it's like, it's not filtered. You know, you don't mean anything mean by it. And I remember thinking, like, well, if they're starving, how come they're so fat? Right? Like, why do they have these big old, like, bellies if they're starving? It doesn't, like, it, didn't make sense to me. Like, no, I'm going to expect to see some kid. And there were some that were like super emaciated in the face. But then they had like these, I don't know if you've seen it, like they look like skeletons, but they have like a Pompeii. Well, the reason for that is because they're so starved of nutrition that the liver is not functioning. So they're not making enough albumin. If you don't make enough albumin, all the fluid that you do have ends out in the perineal cavity. And so this disease state is called kwashiorkor.
K-W-A-S-H-I-O-R-K-O-R.
And so this is actually an indication of true starvation, or a sign in these children of starvation, because their livers, you know, in these little boys is not even working. And so that, I didn't really figure that out until I started teaching this class a few years back, and then I pasted it over top of, you know, a cirrhotic liver alcoholic. But it's very similar pathological problems. Okay, the liver is not working for different reasons, but the result is the same. So this is a malnourishment. There's not enough protein in the diet, and so the albumin is being used by as a fuel source, and then the liver doesn't have enough nutrition to make new albumin. So there's this vicious circle, and they're basically cannibalizing themselves as they starve to death. They get a change in pigment coloration, a huge decrease in muscle mass in these kids, lots of diarrhea, failure to gain weight and grow, and they actually lose their hair. Keratin's a protein, so you know, if you don't have a good diet, plus you won't make quality protein, including hair protein. All right, let's shift gears away from the starving kids to liver disease associated with alcohol abuse. There's three overlapping conditions of liver disease, okay? And they're interconnected. What we all agree upon is that cirrhosis is the worst and is the final stage. What there isn't a lot of consensus on is it steatosis or hepatitis, alcoholic hepatitis, that is the first step. A lot of the data suggests that steatosis, or a fatty liver, is the first stage. And then it moves from a fatty liver to malory bodies and some evidence of inflammation of the liver, which would be a hepatitis situation. And then the third stage is actually cirrhosis. And cirrhosis is defined by scar formation in the tissue, just like a skin scar, just like a scar in the kidneys, okay? Just like a scar on the heart, okay? The liver is gonna have a scar, and it's gonna be a coagulative necrosis because it's a tree-like pattern that perfuses the liver, so it's gonna be coagulative necrosis. So we've got these overlapping conditions. The other thing that we seem to agree upon in the literature is that these first two stages, and that's why they're kind of at the same level, instead of like steatosis, and then we have secondarily hepatitis, and then thirdly, worse, we have cirrhosis. These guys are at the same level. If you have an exposure to either of these, you can go back and forth if you abstain. If you remove the toxin, you can go back and forth. And that's all that alcohol is. It's a hepatotoxin, and I'll explain how it is. Okay, but if the severe exposure is continued and you get down to cirrhosis, you can see there's no line going backwards. Like once you have scar tissue and you've lost functionality, remember that? It's a wound healing event. If you don't have true regeneration and you get scarring and you lose functionality of liver, it's irreversible. And those are the patients that are on transplant lists for a liver transplant. Okay, so what are the risk factors? Well, there's a huge genetic component to it. Some of us are far more predisposed to a liver issue than others. Like, why? I don't know. Some of us are more predisposed to developing strokes. Some of us are going to be more predisposed to developing aneurysms or heart attacks or cancer. Okay, one thing that we all share in common is we all will have something that takes our life. I cannot tell you what it's going to be. But some of us are more genetically predisposed to liver challenges. Okay. cancer is one of them. Now, the literature describes alcohol use as being in the category of risky and then less risky. So greater than 4 drinks per occasion on a regular basis is considered risky use. Okay? Greater than 4 drinks on a regular occasion is considered risky use. You know, and I know, you guys are in college, I get it, I understand, but remember, a lot of the things that we set up as far as habits are stuff that we continue for the rest of our life. I remember, I was exercise science as an undergrad, and I remember in one sports psychology class, the professor made us read this paper about our exercising habits. And it described that by the age of 20, that your exercising habits were set for the rest of your life. You're like, oh, crap, right? And meaning that if you just naturally like to get out and hike, if you like to get into the gym, if you like to take a walk, if you like to walk the dog, by the age of 20, you kind of have fallen into a routine, and you'll probably stay that way for much of your life, unless, you know, you join a gym January 2nd, pay a lot of money, and make a New Year's resolution, right? Well, I'd say, you know, a lot of those habits that I had at the age of 20, 23 years later, they're pretty much accurate. I'm still pretty much exercising at the same level and rate that I was back then. Now the activities and the relative weight has changed a little bit, but the frequency and the focus is what it was even when I was 20 years of age. Okay, and so use of alcohol today, you're setting up social patterns that likely will stay with you for a long time unless you make adjustments. Another publication talks about if you don't have a hangover the next morning, okay, then you probably didn't overdo it the night before. But if you do have a headache or a hangover, you know, and it's like those movies are not a great indication of, you know, it's not black and white, like that's a hangover and anything else is not. But if you feel like you had too much the night before, that was probably risky use, is what they're saying. Like if you're gonna have a meal, you're gonna have a glass of wine or a couple glasses of wine or a beer or a couple glasses of beer, and you and I all know kind of where our limit is. And the next morning, if you feel it, that would probably be considered risky use. But it's time. It's long chronic injury that takes place. So the etiology is excessive alcohol consumption. It damages the microtubules, the mitochondria, as well as the membrane fluidity. So let's talk about exactly what happens. Okay, bless you. Steatosis, we get this cholestasis. This cholestasis that takes place is this fatty change and a lack of bile flow. It cannot flow from the liver to the duodenum. In alcoholic hepatitis, we get hepatocytes that swell. We get the formation of malary bodies. Malary bodies are an alcoholic type of hyaline cartilage that forms, and that's what you're seeing on this photograph. Is you're seeing a normal liver on the left, and a micrograph of histology, and on the lower right, you're seeing a liver that is designated with a number of different malary bodies. So you can see the swelling of the hepatocyte; they're much enlarged, and this dark pink stain in the middle is this hyaline-like cartilage that forms up the malware body. So this is indicative of a alcoholic hepatitis phenotype. And then the last category is cirrhosis. And in cirrhosis, we get this micronodules, we get a shrunken, it's a non-fatty liver because you actually get wounding that takes place. And I'll show you a couple of pictures of cirrhosis here in a second. So what is the pathogenesis? Why is this a problem? Well, here's the equation that we use to break down alcohol, right? So alcohol comes in the presence of NADH, it goes into NAD, it goes into an intermediate acetaldehyde. This is a hepatotoxin in NADH. And this is cleared as acetate. Excess hydrogen ion, or acid, and NADH is produced. And alcohol dehydrates. dehydrogenase is what runs this reaction. So what does NADH do? Well, it inhibits lipolysis and encourages lipogenesis, or the production of new fat cells. And that's where the fatty liver comes from. And so you can see in this picture, this histology, we've got a fatty liver type of phenotype that's taking place. You can appreciate all the open vacuoles. In contrast, if we go back, this is normal liver over here. So in this fatty liver steatosis, and again, this is reversible as long as it doesn't convert to scar, as long as it doesn't convert to fibrosis. Okay, alcohol abuse is in the greatest, alcohol abuse is the greatest among which age group? 15 to 17 year olds, 18 to 29, 30 to 54, or 55 and older?
B.
B? Got it, okay. So what happens with alcoholic hepatitis? Again, here's another picture of Mallory bodies indicative or indicated by the dark hyaline stain that shows up. So acetaldehyde's a hepatotoxin, and that leads to death of the liver cell. When you get this inflammatory event, you get white blood cell recruitment. Again, neutrophils come in first, then macrophages. In the liver, we have a special type of macrophage called the Kupffer cell. The Kupffer cell is a macrophage that's found in the liver itself, and you can kind of appreciate this Kupffer cell right here. This is in a normal liver. Here's an activated Kupffer cell. You can see a stellate cell right here, and then here's an activated stellate cell, and they're making a lot of matrix. And that's the fibrosis that's beginning to take place. And this Kupffer cell is the macrophage that's able to stimulate the inflammatory event at the level of the liver. Why is there an inflammatory event? Because there's a toxin. That hepatotoxin, or that liver toxin, is that intermediate, that acetaldehyde, that's part of this breakdown product of alcohol intermediate. This is the acetaldehyde and NADH. NADH is what upregulates the fat. Acetaldehyde is what kills the liver cells, the hepatocytes. Again, those stellate cells, they start making new matrix. That's where the fibrosis comes from. Again, this is still reversible at the level of alcoholic hepatitis as long as we don't have extensive scarring. Now we get to the final stage. This is cirrhosis. And cirrhosis is really earmarked by repeat stellate stimulation. So those stellate cells make more and more matrix, fibrous matrix from an inflammatory event, because you have repeat exposure to the toxin. That's the acetaldehyde. The Kupffer cells are the macrophage growth factors that are manufactured in that inflammatory tissue, stimulate this ongoing inflammation. And we get a deranged architecture. So now the liver itself becomes hypertensive, because the architecture of the liver is problematic, and so blood flow is no longer normal. So in this particular pentachrome stain, that's a 5-stain, 5 different colors, the lesions that are in pink are all of the stellate fibrosis, right? And they create these nodules. And this is the gross appearance of the liver that has a very similar texture to what we saw in the renal section. You rub your hands over it, you would feel that cobblestone bumps because of all these scars that are actually in the parenchymal tissue of the liver. Okay? So, how do they relate? I would definitely say cirrhosis is the worst. It's earmarked by fibrosis. The other two are stages, and they're probably at equal severity, reversible as long as there's no fibrosis. Steatosis is earmarked by fatty change. Hepatitis is earmarked by Mallory body presence. And again, both of these two states can be reversible as long as we don't have any fibrotic tissue. Clinical manifestations that are shown. Steatosis, you get an enlarged liver. That would be palpable by a physician. They can tell based upon feeling and tapping how big the liver was, okay? They can also tell by acoustics, by tapping, the amount of fibrosis that's present, okay? So if you're worried about it, you might want to go see an osteopath, okay? Because most MDs don't seem to do that anymore. They don't feel bad in the physical exam. Alcohol, hepatitis, there's elevated bilirubin, because one of the functions of the liver is being compromised. Alcoholic hepatitis, general discomfort known as malaise, weight loss, a lack of appetite or anorexia, a lack of interest in eating, a tender liver, okay, it's inflamed. Hyperbilirubinemia, much more elevated than its steatosis, and they may develop symptoms like jaundice. Overin cirrhosis, definitely jaundice, severe weight loss, malaise, weakness, peripheral edema, we talked about ascites, portal hypertension, okay? So, any questions over renal or liver? Awesome. You guys have a great week. Enjoy time with your friends and family. I'll see you guys next Monday.